Well, I think it's time to replace this thing. So, this is the Tesla. This is the Tesla charger, believe it or not. It's in there. You can see the light right there. I made this little box for it after my last charger died, and I had to have Tesla replace it. Tesla replaced it under warranty, but I kept looking at it and thinking, you know what? I think it might be might last a little bit longer if I built this box around it. But you can see the problem here. This is just garbage. Terrible. I built this out of literally old scrap wood that I found laying in the barn, and it was really, really old stuff. So, gonna make a new one. Unfortunately, it still has to face away from the car, which I'm not even gonna get into why it's like that. That's a little, wasn't of my original plan, but here we are. And I got another idea that I kind of want to do too. I don't know if I'm gonna be able to pull it off, but I'll record this now just in case I actually do. You can see through this little window that the little charging indicator's right there, but I have always disliked that it faces away from the house and away from the car. It would be cool if it was over here. And I'm gonna try to figure out some way to make that happen. So anyway, let's go into the barn and take a look at the materials. Hey, while past Gary's making his way over to the barn, future Gary feels like this one deserves a bit of an explanation. The clip that you just watched was filmed nearly 2 years ago, and is only now seeing the light of day for various reasons. Reasons that will become obvious as this video continues. What's important to know at this point is that the voiceover Gary that you are seeing right now is doing the voiceover 2 years later with all the knowledge of what happened throughout the evolution of this solution. When you hear my narrator voice, it's the voice of wisdom and knowledge. When you see me talking on the screen, that's the voice of ignorance and naivety. Anyways, let's keep going. All right, here's what I got. Just a piece of plywood. This is left over from another project. So I guess technically you could call it scrap, but it's not even nearly as scrap as the stuff that I used before. This is actually nice, like, you know, Baltic birch stuff. It's nice and flat and straight. And then I got this, I guess it's called shiplap, right? It's got these little edges cut. You can see this side is shorter than this side, so that when it overlaps, you see a little bit of reveal here. And then I got some 90 degree corners to build out the rest. So I'm gonna make a basic carcass out of the wood, out of the plywood. I'm gonna cover it in this vertically, and then put the edges around the outside. And then I think I'm still gonna keep a cedar roof, because the cedar roof is nice and it will actually withstand the weather. At the end of the day, this is a lesson about complexity and simplicity. It probably isn't obvious at this point, but I'm about to take a simple concept and make an overly complex solution. Now, making a wood box is not the complicated part. I actually really liked the box I made, even though it wasn't really planned out the way I plan things now. I just started making the dimensions on some wood and started cutting. Inexperienced me didn't even account for the thickness of the blade in my measurements. So, while I continue measuring and cutting, let's revisit the couple problems I'm trying to solve. One, as I'm sure you can tell, I don't have a garage. The car and the charger are outside and exposed through hot and cold, through snow and rain. Like I mentioned before, this is the second charger. The first one broke and was replaced under warranty. It seemed like putting a little roof over it would protect it somewhat from the elements. Second, and I'm not 100% clear on how this happened, the charger faces away from the car and, more importantly, away from the house. This bothers me probably way more than it should. And this issue is ultimately the reason that I have now remade this little charger cover thing three times. Yeah, three times. The one you saw in the opening clip, the one past me is making right now, and the one past me will end up making after this one fails to deliver on solving the problem that I'm explaining. I really want to be able to see the charger status lights from my house. So yeah, making this box is not the problem. The problem is, and will be, how I plan on making the indicator lights visible to me in the house. And speaking of the problem, let's get back to past me so I can describe my harebrained plan.
So, it's been like 5 seconds for you and it's been like a week for me, but I've definitely gone the route of overengineering this. Let me show you. I think what I'm going to try to do here is kind of crazy, but I hope it all works out. This is an ESP32 dev chip. It's like a little microcontroller. And I've got these little gizmos here. This takes power in from a solar panel and charges the battery. And then the power goes out to this adapter here that steps it up to 5 volts, which is USB voltage. And then from there, that goes into this microcontroller. The microcontroller is then connected to this LED strip. Obviously the LED strip is a little long right now. I'm gonna shorten this down. But the idea here is to mimic the lights that are on the front of the Tesla charger.
So fast forward through all the other stuff, I eventually assembled the entire thing, tested it in my window, and everything seemed pretty promising. It was up and running, and I was pretty happy with it. Now, if you ask me, it was a really cool solution, but I missed something critical. Do you know what it is? Take a guess. Let me know in the comments if you got it right. I do want to expand a little bit on how the whole thing works, because I think it has potential. So while I finish building the box, here's a little more detail. The little light strip essentially reacts to what the charger is doing. So while I'm using this to mimic the charger's indicator lights, you could apply the same concept to lots of stuff. The LED strip is connected to an ESP32 board, and the board is running ESP Home. I've made a few videos about ESP Home, and I'll put links to those in the description. But ESP Home is a super simple way to control stuff connected to an ESP32 with Home Assistant.
It's fine.
Most of the magic happens in Home Assistant. It's where the instructions and the connections kind of live. I have my Tesla charger integrated with Home Assistant, so Home Assistant knows what the charger's doing at all times. I think the primary purpose of this integration was to keep track of energy consumption, but I'm using it to keep track of the status codes that indicate what the charger is doing, and by relation, what the lights on the charger are doing. Next, I have an automation in Home Assistant that reacts to when the status of the charger changes. When that happens, Home Assistant tells the ESP32 to update the LED strip. It's not super complicated, but it does have one major flaw that I didn't account for. To future me that's talking to you right now, it seems so obvious. Like, how did I not check this totally obvious potential problem when I was designing this whole thing? Okay, so back to the build for a bit. So I don't know if this is the most effective way to do this, but I was pretty happy with the outcome. When it came to putting the shiplap on the outside of the box, instead of attempting to pre-cut and match all the dimensions, I just put them on the carcass purposefully oversized. After the glue was dry, I used the palm router with a flush trim bit to make the shiplap the exact same size as the plywood carcass. Now, wiser future me knows that I probably shouldn't just plow through a solid piece of wood like this because it could break the bit. But past me had no idea and it worked out fine. Ignorance is bliss, I guess? If you want to try this, maybe get a little closer to the actual size and then just do fine tuning with the router. It'll take a little bit longer, but it's a safer move. If you're like me and don't have a joiner, this little trick works like a charm. As you can see, the cedar I was using for the roof is cupped like crazy. To fix this, take the cup material and put it on a flat surface. Next, put any kind of support under the material so the planer can't squish it when it goes through. Now, put it through the planer like normal until one side is flat. Next, take it off the flat surface, flip it over, and plan the other side so that side's flat. It works like a charm every time. One thing I learned from this project is that iteration on physical stuff is hard. As you may or may not know, my professional background is in web development and software engineering. In software, it's very common to build a basic product, know it will have flaws, and then improve on it over time. I would personally argue that this iterative approach is the best approach to creating software if you have the ability to release frequently with little impact to the end user. Now, with that said, I naturally think that iterating on designs for stuff that I would make would also make sense. But it turns out it's a little more complicated with physical stuff for a few reasons. One, making stuff costs money. If you make something physical, you're spending money on material. If you decide you don't like a part of it, you'll likely be throwing that part away. That seems wasteful to me in a trash in a landfill kind of way, as well as in a I just wasted money on stuff kind of way. Two, if you don't make the thing you're making modular enough, you won't be able to improve on it without just throwing the whole thing away. Now, I said this is different from software, but really that one isn't that far off. When you create software, you need to plan around how certain parts can be replaced in the future without destroying the entire program. Doing it with physical stuff is very similar. In the case of this project, looking back at it, I think I could have improved on this until it was right. I could have possibly fixed the flaws in my plan. But at the same time, the conclusion I came to was that if I fixed the problem in front of me, it would have resulted in another problem.
And that's how you make your own custom charger. Now, what I don't know is, I gotta get the light to turn on.
You see, Wi-Fi consumes a lot of energy. Also, LED strips consume energy. Also, constantly listening for status changes consumes energy. And all of that energy consumption needs to be offset by the solar panel, or eventually, you'll end up with this. The battery is effectively dead, and the solar panel is attempting to power the whole system directly. There just isn't enough sunlight to keep this thing afloat for a long period of time. It might work for a week or two, but eventually one cloudy day will ruin the pattern. So that was pretty defeating. So defeating, in fact, that I left it out there for about 6 months before I even started thinking about how I was going to fix it. But eventually, I couldn't take it anymore, and I had to try again. This time, I had some new skills, I also had some new tools, and probably more importantly, I had some insights into why simplicity might be a better solution. So, what are the new tools, you ask? Well, of course it's a 3D printer. I'm sure present me knows that present you already knows that I have a 3D printer. Because you've already watched other videos of mine, right? Because you're subscribed, right? I got a 3D printer sometime in the last year. It was after the creation of the first solution, but when I got it, I don't think I had the 3D modeling skills to make what I had in mind. So maybe it's a good thing that I ignored this project for a little while. Anyways, here's the design. And for the sake of suspense, I'm not going to go into detail about the functionality of it. For now, you can see the outside. It's roundish. It has Tesla logos, and it has a built-in charging cable hook, as well as a spot to hang the handle when it's not in use. But you know there's more to it. Just the looks would only solve one of my two problems. I find it difficult to make videos about 3D printed projects, especially when they aren't any more than just a design that gets 3D printed and it's done. It's not like watching me model something is exciting. Also, time-lapse videos of 3D prints coming together get a little old after you've seen them a few hundred times. So here's what might be interesting about this specific print. One, it's huge. So huge, in fact, that I had to split it into four chunks, and that doesn't even include the lid. I used a bamboo slicer to split it into four pieces and place pins for joining it back together after it was printed. It's actually just held together with super glue. Two, it's multicolor and printed in PETG. This is specifically Bamboo Lab's high-flow PETG that claims to withstand heat like PETG, but print as fast as PLA. And after using it, I can at least vouch for the speed part. As for standing up to being outside in all kinds of conditions, only time will tell. Now, the third and final part you might find of interest. It's actually maybe the part you've been waiting for. How did I get the lights to work? Well, this time, it's pretty simple. I mean, it's kind of simple. The end solution, I think, is, let's use the word elegant. Let me know if you agree. I'm using optic fibers to quote-unquote move the light around to the other side of the enclosure. I'm sure you've seen this before. A lot of people use them to make fake starry sky ceilings in their house, or sometimes you see them in like limos and other kind of fancy vehicles. The idea is pretty simple. The light enters one side and illuminates the other side of the fiber. Now, this is the polar opposite of the solution I designed in the first place. There are no electronics, and there are no parts that can fail. Just the fibers. But that's not to say that this is all super simple. I obviously had to design the enclosure with a channel for the fibers. I also had to cut and jam all the fibers through the enclosure. But overall, not too bad. After getting all the fibers counted and crammed and cut, I then made a little cover out of clear PETG and slid it into the slot that I designed into the box. Finally, to mount this outside, I needed some brackets. I just got these at the big box store, and I had some pre-designed holes in the bottom of the enclosure for them to attach. I used washers to fine-tune the placement outside and get the alignment exactly right. But does it actually work? Yeah, well, mostly. I'd be lying if I said I was 100% satisfied with the end result. Sure, you can see the light, but you can't see it from really far away. Now, I might be nitpicking, but I would like it to be brighter. I'm not sure how I would do that without reintroducing the LEDs. Or, you know, I could just move the pole to the other side of the charger and turn the thing to face the house.